بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Unfortunately, many of the younger generation are sometimes put off from learning religious knowledge. And there are many reasons for that. Primarily, it's shaitan and his plan. If the parents do not inculcate from a young age the fact that these children need to be encouraged towards the deen of Allah and the importance of learning and teaching and the reward therein, perhaps we may have a void. If we are 2 billion plus Muslims on earth, how many scholars do you think we need? We need a few million at any given time. And no matter how many they are, it will not be enough. Because there are people, not just in your small circle, but across the globe, who are in need of guidance and reminders and various levels of encouragement and learning. But my brothers and sisters, from a young age, shaitan tempers. If that environment and upbringing is not in the right direction, nobody would be interested in learning the deen of Allah in order to teach it to others. Similarly, when you learn, you need to know, as you grow in your knowledge and you go out in the field in order to teach, you must face obstacles. You will face people saying things about you. You will face people trying to block your path, because that is what happened to the prophets of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon them all. And this is the reason why the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man salaka tariqan yaltamisu fihi ilma." Whoever treads a path in which he is seeking knowledge, or she is seeking knowledge, sahhalallahu lahu bihi tariqan ila al-jannah. Allah Almighty makes easy for that person, because of that, the path to paradise. You have to bear patience to learn. You have to learn. You have to memorize the Quran, memorize the hadith. You have to learn what the scholars have said, how it's interpreted, the differences of opinion, why they are there, what are the evidences on all the sides, which evidence is more correct, which evidence is acceptable, even though it may not be the absolute correct opinion according to you, but it is acceptable because it has some form of evidence. And which opinion is completely baseless because it is based on thin air. May Allah Almighty grant us a deep understanding and good beneficial knowledge. Ameen. The reason I started off this way is because when we lead Salatul Taraweeh, the idea is to hand over to the next generation. When are you going to come up and take over from us? We would love to see the young come up, do that hifz and memorize the Quran and master it and learn the knowledge and get up and deliver what needs to be delivered in terms of reminders. You, the youth who are listening to me this evening, make an effort, do something, try your best. It's not going to be an easy path, but it is the path to success. It is the true way that the messengers of Allah, who were most loved by Allah, were blessed with. And it is the path of the messengers. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي. Say, tell them, this is my path. What is it? I call towards Allah. That's what I do. The life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what was it all about? He called towards Allah. He called in the daytime, he called at night. He taught them specified knowledge. He called the non-Muslims, he called the Muslims. He spoke to those who hated him, he spoke to those who loved him. He spoke to his family members, he spoke to the young and old, the far and the near. He tried with every single one of them. He rendered help to those who needed help, and he did a lot. Everything, every department there is of what we know as calling towards Allah or the da'wah. Every department was covered by the messenger because he was a messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But you and I are weak. I can only do the covering of one or two departments. I can only do the covering of one or two departments, and so can you. And together we will be able to cover the 70 or 80 or even 100 different departments that were covered by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Today when I see people visiting the inmates in the prisons, I say, wallahi, he or she is fulfilling a duty that we as an ummah have. I support them, I salute them, and I pray for them. I'm not jealous of them. I'm not upset because they are doing something different. Today when I see scholars, for example, teaching in the madrasa, tahfidh, which is very difficult. They are teaching little children to learn the Quran, to memorize the Quran. I salute them, I pray for them, I respect them. I know they are doing a job I am supposed to be doing because it's a duty of the ummah. I'm not jealous of them. I don't hate them. If anything, I'm very proud of them. Today when I see scholars in the masajid giving lectures and talks, that is what some of them are supposed to be doing, mashallah. We're happy, we're delighted. When we see scholars in the seminaries of learning and the universities who are sitting and teaching the in-depth rules and regulations to a handful of people who want to learn more. Because remember, it's not everyone's duty to know every single ruling of Islam. The general masses only need to know what is necessary. It's called ma huwa ma'lumun min ad-din bid-darura. Those things regarding your faith that you have to know by hook or crook. You have to know certain things, halal, haram, your cleanliness, your tawheed, your five pillars of Islam, the pillars of Iman, and so on. You have to know these certain things. Every single one, but you don't need to know every single detail of every ruling. When you want to find out something, you can ask someone who has specialized. And who specializes? Just a handful. So those scholars who are sitting giving what is known as lessons, be it in the masjids or in the madrasas, we salute them. And we really believe they are true scholars who are doing a good job. We are proud of them. We are happy that they are serving the ummah. We are not jealous of them. We don't hate them. We're not abusive. They're covering. Perhaps they are speaking to a handful or a group of people. Not everyone needs to teach that way. Not everyone who does not teach that way is not a scholar. Because people think that if you are a scholar, you are supposed to sit and teach the way I was taught by my scholars. That's not true. They don't need to do it that way. If there are millions of scholars, wallahi, we need to diversify. Some need to be out fighting the enemy. Some need to be out trying to teach the non-Muslims and giving them some of the deen. Some need to be out teaching the weak Muslims. Some need to be out teaching those who would like to learn in detail. Some need to be teaching the children, the alif and ba. Others need to be doing tahfidh. Others need to be reaching out in the prisons to those who are sick and ill. Some are in charge of some of the burial committees where a person passes away. And you know what? They make it so easy. Do you know in your community there has to be a burial committee who, as soon as someone passes away, is called first, and they come with a smile on their faces, even though it's a tough moment, subhanallah. A smile meaning they're happy to do the job for you. They're earning reward. They're earning mountains of reward. Are you going to be a part of the burial committee? Many people will say, no, I don't have the time. Well, be proud of those who do have the time. They are doing you a favor, and I. Similarly, when you have a marital problem, where are the scholars who do some counseling or arbitrations? They are there. They are also learned. They have a lot of knowledge. They may not want to show it and expose it. They might not be teaching every single subject there is to be taught, but they are involved in a certain department within the ummah. They are important. We respect them. We consider them scholars, and we really are proud of what they are doing. Similarly, when people are going through issues with their children, issues in the community, who is there? There will be different types of scholars. Not all of them are going to be teaching the way your sheikh taught you. So today, if you witness the children, as they grow older, they learn. Where do they learn from? One of the sources that they learn from, whether you like it or not, is online. Whether you like it or not, is online. It is a double-edged sword, because you know what? You need to be extremely careful how you use your devices. But this is the month of Ramadan. I want to tell you, my brothers and sisters, seize the opportunity to listen to something good, to do something good, to benefit yourself, to attend online classes from those who are reputable. Expand your knowledge. Don't spread hurt and hate. Don't become a vehicle of pointing at scholars simply because they're not doing what you think they should be doing. There are some busy compiling books. There are some who are busy with websites, some who are busy with applications, some who are helping you in ways you can't imagine. I know of scholars who are busy trying to create cartoons for children because they see that the cartoons the children have been watching, and we've never been able to get them off the cartoons completely, are heading them in the wrong direction. So the solution is to bring in that which is going to teach them the deen of Allah in a playful manner, in a lovely, beautiful way. They're going to be watching small little cartoons, and as they come out, they are reading the du'as, they are singing an-nasheed, they know how to respect their elders, they know who is the sheikh and the imam and what's the value of that person. Why? Because there's someone in the ummah who is making those cartoons. If you think you don't have that problem, wait until you have children and see what happens. Then you will appreciate those who did those cartoons. For now, you might be refuting and sitting and swearing and abusing and so on. But don't do that. Try to appreciate what everyone is doing. Sometimes if you were to remove some of these scholars that you love to refute from the face of the earth, you might create a little bit of a vacuum, but you don't realize that. So each one is specialized in his or her own way. I started off by saying the children are discouraged because they witness scholars fighting each other. They witness scholars talk about each other. Some of them are specialized in studying the lives of others who are doing the work and finding fault. Now, unfortunately, that is a sign of rejection. You see, when you are supposed to be doing hard work, say you're a mechanic and you're supposed to be repairing the vehicles, but you're not repairing the vehicles, you're watching others who are fixing the cars. And by the way, nowadays, if you're a mechanic and there's a Tesla around the corner, you might not be able to touch it because you're going to need to go for a course before you know what a Tesla is all about. Because if you're trying to use whatever you had in terms of you're learning 5 years or 10 years ago, it's not going to work with some of these new vehicles. You need to update and upgrade. So when you see a younger guy dealing with a Tesla, for example, don't be jealous of him. Don't abuse him. Some people, when they are mechanics, instead of fixing the vehicles, they sit and watch others and say, this guy doesn't know what he's doing. That guy's going to mess up all the cars. This guy's caused problems in the vehicles. But what have you done? What have you done? How have you even repaired the first vehicle? Can you show us? So this is why we say in every field, this is what happens. Those who know, they know that they know. And then they are busy doing hard work. They don't have the time to look at another mechanic because I'm so busy with my work. I've got 100 vehicles. If anything, I wouldn't mind giving you 10 of my cars because I can't cope. That's how busy I am. But what are you busy doing? You're busy pointing fingers. And as a result, the others who become mechanics, they either join you in pointing fingers or they are going to be repairing vehicles with all the others. Same applies in knowledge. Some sit back and they talk about this one and that one. They'll print pamphlets. They will put articles. What are they doing themselves? How did they serve the broader masses? Did they take the deen to the non-Muslims? Did they ever think of talking or addressing or engaging the haters who hate Islam? In order to try and give them a picture of what Islam really is, they may not accept Islam. Let them listen to what you have to say and say, wow, I used to think Islam is a terrible religion filled with extremism, but now I've understood that in fact it is a religion that has good and blessed teachings. How do they know? Someone, somewhere, somehow specialized in teaching them and reaching them. And you are busy sitting in your masjid, mashallah, doing a good job perhaps as an imam. In your spare time, you're busy poking fun at those who are really doing a tremendous job, but in a different department of the same da'wah. May Allah grant us an understanding. We need these people. Sometimes you have the majority of Muslims, as you and I know, are not fully practicing. Most of us, 95% of us, are struggling to become better Muslims. Who cares for you? Who makes you feel like, you know what, go for it. Come, let's go. You're doing well. Mashallah, alhamdulillah, don't worry. Oh, you slipped. Come up. Let's engage in tawbah. Ask Allah's forgiveness and let's start again. Come back. Mashallah, we need you. We love you. We care for you. Let's go. Who is doing that? Who is cheering those who need the cheering? Trust me, if someone's doing it, congratulate them. help them, support them, understand they may not be doing what other scholars are doing, but wallahi, they are fulfilling a massive void in the ummah. If you take them out of the equation, who is there for our children? When I see the children of others, youngsters, I love to give them time because I see my own kids in them. And I tell myself, if I'm not going to just smile at this youngster, perhaps greet him and say, mashallah, you're looking handsome. What did I do? I empowered him with a statement of confidence. That's all I did. Because the children, many of the adults, they just rattle out negatives. You know what? You're useless. You know what? You're rubbish. You're not going to be able to achieve anything. You are nothing. Don't even try. Don't waste your time. You came out last. These are the statements that are being told to our children. They are discouraged. Where are those who are telling them, well done, my son. You did well. That one word will change his life. Wallahi. But we don't think that way. Because we don't care for the ummah. So if you know someone who cares for the ummah, value that person. Wallahi, you need them and your children need them. May Allah Almighty grant us ease. So youngsters are discouraged because when they see the fighting, when they see the scholars swearing each other, mocking at each other, calling each other bad names, you're not even a Muslim. And imagine the guy reads the whole Quran every third day. And others are saying, you're not even a Muslim. And people are saying, well, this person, there's something wrong with him. He's a deviant. And so on. I'm not saying that you should not engage in discussing difference of opinion and correcting one another, but it needs to be respectful because everyone is watching. Would you like to guide people? Well, then do the guidance and the guiding with wisdom. Allah tells you, you address the non-Muslims with wisdom. What about the Muslims? With even more wisdom, inshallah. So here goes. If you want the children to come up, firstly, can I say something controversial? You need to double the salary of your imam. That's the first thing. Because the job of that scholar and that imam is nothing. When people, youngsters, see how much these imams are getting, I'm not going to be an imam. Imagine if my cherry wanted a cherry. I wouldn't even be able to buy it. And a cherry is a Chinese motor vehicle, by the way. Right? I can't even afford it because I'm going to be an imam. I'm going to have to get a lift and go in public transport. So when the imam is getting a top salary, wallahi, naturally people look and say, hey, I want to be an imam. Because at school they are taught, what would you like to become? Become something that's going to bring you some income, that's going to get you a life. That's what they teach you at the schools. They say, well, I want to be an imam. You know, from all religions, Islam is the religion where, unfortunately, the religious personnel are the least paid. You go and check it. Do a search online. You will notice others are paid thousands of dollars. But the imams, Allahu Akbar, do you know what we tell them? Inshallah, imam, your reward is with Allah. You will get Jannah. He says, but I need to live. The imam is not allowed to buy a car. He can't have new clothes. He's not allowed to come in with oud and proper perfume. He's not allowed to have, subhanallah, so many things just because the culture has set the wrong trend. Let's change that. Let's change that. And you see the youngsters tomorrow, they'll all apply to be scholars. And they learn. They won't learn in order to earn, but survival. Survival. Imagine, not everyone is fortunate enough to be a scholar and a businessman at the same time, or to have a supplementary income. But we need definitely to make the path such that the youngsters look and they enjoy it. I like to tell the kids, do you know what? I get a lot of hate, I get refutations, I get people calling me names, they call me kafir, they call me fasiq and fajir, they call me whatever, but a million times over, I wouldn't mind all of that, seeing what Allah has chosen us to do. I wouldn't mind. I really don't. When someone says whatever, you get to a level where you actually pity them because they don't know something you know. That's it. You pity them. You feel sorry for them. A guy one day spat at me. In fact, there were three youngsters. This guy spits in my direction. I just looked at him and I pitied him because I'm thinking to myself, what did that gain you? I know where I've gotten. I know what I have. What did it gain you? I wouldn't mind smiling and saying, oh, I'm sorry, my son, what's going on? Don't son me here, okay? All right, my daughter, what's going on? Meaning, what would you like me to say? So we cannot get upset and cross because I know what I have. Imagine you're a doctor and you're a qualified doctor and you've been doing, for example, surgeries for the last 15 years and then comes a young guy who's not even qualified and he looks and says, you don't know anything. He wants to spit in your direction. You're going to say, guess what? You, your father, and your grandfather. I treated all of you guys, but you don't even know. Allahu Akbar. You just got to chill. You just got to take it easy. I want to encourage the youngsters. Learn. Don't learn in order to argue with people and in order to boast and brag with your knowledge. Even if you have a lot, be humble. You don't need to argue. You don't need to become a person who's sitting online and picking on every other scholar and dropping to prove who you are. I'm the man. It's not a boxing fight. It's not Tyson versus Fury and so on. It is actually serving the same cause. You're working for the same boss, that is Allah. So come on, help them, say good about them. Someone's making a mistake. You don't need to publicly shame them. You can address it. Sometimes it might be a difference of opinion. So this evening, mashallah, second night of Ramadan, it is the month of knowledge. Many people don't say that. How knowledge? Because the Quran is the root of all knowledge. That's why. The word of Allah. The month of knowledge, encourage each other to learn, to study, to increase in knowledge, to teach others, and to keep going. My beloved children, boys and girls, do something to expand your knowledge. And when you expand it, start practicing. And when you practice, start teaching others. And I'm going to tell you one thing in order to end this talk. True knowledge comes with humbleness. When you see a really knowledgeable person, they will be very humble. If they're not humble, they're not knowledgeable. Arrogant. Look at everyone else like, what do you guys know? I'm the Don. You're the Don. Yeah? Subhanallah. True knowledge comes with humility, humbleness. It comes with selflessness. You want to help everyone because you have knowledge. You don't belittle anyone. You watch what you say. That's true knowledge. It softens you. It doesn't make you hard. When you know Allah, you become soft. Look at what Allah says in the Quran about the most blessed, the most knowledgeable from all of us, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says,
فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَظًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ.
It is by the mercy of Allah, a sign of the mercy of Allah, that you are lenient towards the others, meaning his companions. It's a sign of the mercy of Allah when you are lenient. The opposite is true, that when you are not lenient, it's a sign that Allah has no mercy on you, in the sense that you are far from the mercy of Allah because you don't have leniency. So calm down. Look at people with love. You look at a person, don't look with the eye of hate. Look with the eye of love. You'll find a lot. They will connect with you because the eyes are filled with love. It's easy to pick it up. The hearts have an energy that is felt. Subhanallah. So Allah says, if you were harsh and hard-hearted, they would disperse from around you. When the imam comes up, for example, and he says, guys, you guys are going to hellfire. Everybody's going to burn. And you know what? You rather start now testing your levels of tolerance with candles because you guys are going to burn. I mean, that would be absurd. Am I right? But sometimes you hear a talk and they've belittled the masses in such a way that everyone walks down with their heads in shame, that I don't ever want to come back to listen to a talk in this masjid. I know of a certain imam, lovely brother, but too hard-hitting. When people come to the door on a Friday and see him there, they quickly run out and rush to another masjid nearby. Imagine. Come on. May Allah Almighty help us to respect one another. May Allah Almighty help us respect all scholars, no matter what they are doing. Some of them, even if they are just involved in business or involved in something else, wallahi, the fact that they are knowledgeable, we honor that fact. And we know that we can learn a thing or two from them. And I'd like to remind those who are learning, those who have learned, go easy on your colleagues. Don't just bash them. Don't just refute them. We are all part of the ummah of the same Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You never know who is closer to Allah. You never know who is winning the race. And here you are sitting and pointing fingers. May Allah never let that happen to us. May Allah use us all to serve a good cause. I see young faces this evening, and wallahi, it brings joy to my heart. And I thought this word of encouragement would boost you, would help you to say, you know what, go for it. It's not an easy task, but memorize the Quran, learn some knowledge, help other people, develop good character, good companionship, have good friends, come to the masjid together. Like I've always said, pray together, play together. You should pray together and play together. If you want to know who do I play with, say you play with those whom you pray with, because they pray. That's the reason. If they don't pray, they're not worth playing with. May Allah Almighty forgive all of us. And I pray that we have a blessed month of Ramadan. This was the last of my talks in this masjid. And inshallah, tomorrow I will be in Makkatul Mukarramah. By this time, I ask Allah Almighty to take us, inshallah, make the journey easy. I will pray that Allah bring all of you there as well. Forgive all our shortcomings. Make Ramadan easy for all of us. Accept our fasting and accept our qiyam and ibadah, our charities. May Allah transform us in this month of Ramadan such that we've never been before, in a way that inshallah it takes us straight to Jannatul Firdaus. Ameen. Ya Rabbal Alameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabina Muhammad. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.